Parental discretion is advised.
Shop WWEShop.com. Now you can get $10 off any order of $70 or more. Click on the link on WrestlingMayhemShow.com to support the mayhem.
This is .com from NBC's 30 Rock, and I want to give a shout-out to Wrestling Mayhem Show. Those are my dudes. What's up, y'all? I'm keeping an eye on y'all. Stay out of trouble.
Hey, guys. Welcome to Wrestling Mayhem Show 293. We got a hell of a show set up for you. We'll be talking a little bit to the promoter of River City Wrestling, Brandon Oliver from down there. Wrestlefan's homegrown interview. We're excited for that.
Now.
What's that?
I'm a big boy interviewer.
You're
now.
A big boy interviewer. You're all grown up.
All
professional and shit. Let's go around the board.
And then you say that.
And then he says that, yes.
And you turn back into a fetus.
With me right here Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA, on the couch, probably playing some Madden, is Mr. Chachi of ChachiSays.net, ChachiPlays.com.
Hi.
And that's all he's got.
Yep.
That's all he's got. And also from Parts Unknown is DJ Lunchbox. Nice profile. Hi.
I thought you stopped playing the video games.
I thought he was going to go into some Alfred Hitchcock.
What's going on?
Are you sniffing us?
Yeah.
What's up, hot dogs? It's DJ Lunchbox back on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. You're so sexy. I just want to make out with all of you.
Wow.
God.
And on the other side of sanity is the Rizz.
Hey, Rizz.
Hi. Yeah, this has been the week of the Rizz, I gotta tell you. Not only do I have my tweet published on WWE.com,
yes,
I have
do.
My own Memorial Cup tournament.
Hold on, I got the
which is funny because I didn't know you were dead.
Hold on, you threw. You threw this at me. I wasn't prepared for the links.
There is coming live here on the Wrestling Mayhem Show from heaven.
From heaven.
Here you go. First,
Rizz would go to heaven.
Available on highspots.com, the Super Rizz Tournament DVD. apparently, I didn't know your name was Jason Lee Smith in Brentwood, California. That was interesting.
Super Rizz.
And your tweet. Tell us about your tweet.
Well,
no one cares.
I was looking. Okay.
Shut up, Chachi.
Chachi. Stop shooting him down.
Stop stepping on me, Chachi.
I'm not stepping on you.
Stop it. Stop it.
Well, the tweet was derived from months and months of thoughtless tweeting. And
as you would do.
As I do all day. And there was one instance in Raw that really caught my eye, and that was Alberto Del Rio has an easy pass on his car.
Yes, he does.
And I tweeted that, and it was posted on WWE.com.
Yeah, the day after Raw, where I guess Joey Styles posts a bunch of random tweets from the evening. And if we
Joey Styles is awesome.
If we go right down here, and here is at Rizz, IUPLLL, Del Rio has an easy pass on his car, WWE Raw. So it pays to use your hashtags, kids. Make sure you use your hashtags.
You can become famous and shit.
That's right. Like the Rizz, like our own
Rizz. I'm already famous.
Who's, who is, by the way, sandwiched on here between Sarcastic _ Viper, who has a comment about Rodney Dangerfield, and Cena Orton Baby. Tell me that you respect me.
Cena Orton Baby?
Yes, and something about Aretha Franklin. Rodney Dangerfield, Rizz, and Aretha Franklin. So there you go. Also, from San Antonio, Texas, is the Wrestlefan.
Yes.
The Wrestlefan of the week? What?
Whoa.
Are you serious, bro?
Whoa.
With the
newly... Yes, you can tell. I am your number one broski for this week.
With his newly trademarked broski headband.
Yes, which I got the pay-per-view that I went to this past weekend, which we'll talk about later. But I want to thank WWE Shop because they are smart people that... For $10, you can get at the merch tables a broski headband and an autographed picture of the one and only Zack Ryder.
There you go.
Woo, woo, woo.
Nice.
And
woo,
you woo, bought woo. Right into it.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, you're a broski sucker. No. I would have bought the same thing.
I would have bought the same thing.
Yeah. All I got at the last show was a Nexus armband, which hardly fits my arm.
I actually got that the last WWE event I went to.
When they were the hot thing. Well, hey guys, you stumbled on the Wrestling Mayhem show. We do this thing live every Tuesday at 8:30 p.m. roundabouts Eastern time, live.sorgatronmedia.com. Find out more info about us. You want to know what's going on? WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Tweet us at Mayhem Show. Also, drop us emails at
good times.
good times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com or 412
Angry Velociraptor at WrestlingMayhemShow.com.
412-206-WMS-09670 for the layman phone users. Hey, we're on iTunes, we're on Blip TV, we're on the Stitcher, the MediaFly, the YouTube, the Roku boxes.
We have an app.
And we have an app for that as well, as Rizz is pointing out right there on the Android and your iOS devices. It's $1.99. Gives you fast access to all those things. You don't have to remember phone numbers. And you also
get
gold content exclusive for that ass. Right,
gents. Gents, breaking news.
Yes.
The Pens. They won. The Pens won.
Oh, I knew. Yeah.
The Pens won. I just got my ESPN Score Center update.
I did too. Right when I did that. Something. Right when
you
I held
tell.
It up.
Most of us are in Pittsburgh, PA. Yeah. Hey, you know, we got stickers, guys. Send your stickers. WMS stickers, care of Sorgatron Media. 1535 Belasco Avenue, Pittsburgh, stickers. PA. 15216. We'll send you an arm length of those stickers right there, just for sending a sassy. Send a sassy self. Address stamped envelope.
Sassy
envelope. Sassy.
Sassy.
We
sassy
love your fan mail. Oh, and we also love the WrestlingRevolution.com that support our site, and therefore we support them. They're a pretty keen message board where, you know, I went through some of the old message boards, like some of the old indie ones. Some certain eye-bleeding indie ones. They're not as hot as they used to be. There's not as many people complaining and diarrhea of the mouthing on them as there used to be. This one one is cleaner and no mop needed. And people aren't dicks like that. And they post some cool videos. They got some great content over there. So go check those guys out and support them and support the Mayhem Show.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hot. Speaking of feedback, Twitter. People were tweeting this week. I want to shout out some people that are tweeting. Yes, you were. Rizz, of course. Matt Carlins, @MattCarlins. He has been following the Attorney at Raw saga. He likes what he's seeing from David Atunga, Attorney at Raw. #
Dun, dun.
Committing to the blow tie and adding travel coffee mug.
Blow tie.
Thank you very much, Matt Carlins.
You said blow tie.
Sounds like a bow tie.
And SSJ04 Mew2 tells us a good podcast. Learned this week that anytime during the wrestling show that is outside of the U.S., you may get deported. Now I know. We also had some great pictures that were submitted on the Twitterscapes. AJ always has some pretty good ones, and I'm not authorized to see this. All right, work on that. We'll get to his in a second. Hopefully this one will work. I need to log in. That's why. Yep, that's why.
Yeah.
Can you turn me back up?
I did turn you back
up. Oh, okay. I couldn't hear me.
I didn't mean to step on you.
Don't step. No. Don't step on him.
Stepping. You didn't step on me. I just didn't know I was turning.
I think you did. I think you totally did.
Turn his headphones up.
Oh, no. Yeah, this is something from Raw last night that's loading here. What? What?
What?
John Cena's nice got a little capture. Bibble.
John Cena, no,
John
no,
Cena theory. Bibble.
The we hate Cena guy. By the way, two nights in a row, that guy was sitting there, and we were saying in the hangout that he's a new hat guy.
He's a new sign guy.
He's a new sign guy. Okay, all right. And then the picture I really wanted to show off. His tweet goes: John Cena's phlegm looks awfully suspicious. And
John Cena spit up on
I mean,
himself.
He was only there for a moment. They definitely got the camera off of him as quick as possible, but it's definitely a little suspicious what's going on there. I hope nobody uses that microphone after him. That's very, very rough. Very rough. But, you know, when it's a tough night like that.
Too soon.
So
man,
we got
night, baby,
and we got some emails proper as well. We had some feedback about the app we were talking about. Hi, it's Neil from Cambridge, England, home of a lot of free pay-per-views like tonight's Vengeance, and we still get superstars. They're the lucky ones.
Wow.
Just emailing and bragging a little bit. Just emailing to let you know that the Android app is great and you should encourage other listeners to buy it. Great value. Keep up the good work. And it says, sent from my microwave oven.
Yeah, when I was using the Android app, it ran pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
I
mean, that's a nice microwave oven.
Yeah, that's a pretty spacious microwave oven, too.
I wonder if it runs Android. Maybe I didn't know you could buy our app on a microwave oven.
Oh, ice cream sandwich would get all melty.
Yeah.
a tech joke.
He rooted his microwave.
You rooted his
microwave? Yeah, that's what it was.
Wrestlefan, you have a duty to perform right now.
I do?
And you have to read the entire thing.
No.
Oh, wait, no, that's
the other one. Are you sure you don't want to save this for indie minutes?
I think I'm confusing them.
Yeah, wait a minute.
I'm going to go ahead and call dibs on Sonic Screwjob.
All right, go for it.
All right, now?
Yeah, go for it.
All right. Weekly World News. Greetings, Mayhemers. I missed the pay-per-view, so I had to catch up on Raw last night on Raw. That's my fault, not his. I see Del Rio retained by outside interference, which is okay, because heel heat sells Slurpee cups too, and Cena can't have the belt all the time. I see both my wellness policy and Star Wars theories are still valid with the return of Darth Nash, even though I forgot to mention the Senate, quote, vote of no confidence last time. I only have one question, and I'll lead with some observations. Let me get this straight. Triple H is hospitalized with a possible broken neck. R-Truth and Miz are running roughshod in and out of the ring. All the divas are missing, kidnapped by aliens, except for five. Punk can't get a title shot, and Ricardo has another black guy? It's dark times on Raw, my friends, but don't worry. The Muppets will be here next week. Is it just me, or does the writer's timing seem a little bit off? I haven't got to catch up on TNA Bound for Glory, but I'm sure someone turned on their partner or group. Gunnar ran in on a match, and someone cut a promo while being filmed through an open office door. Have a great show, guys. Sonic Screwjob. P.S. I just wanted to offer my condolences to John Morrison's career. You know, I'm sure Melina is a great catch, but next week when Morrison is jobbing to Gonzo in a lumberjack match with a ring surrounded by chicken puppets,
awesome.
He should think about trying to get in the higher up's good graces. Good stuff. Big fan.
There's more to that email.
What? Bullshit.
Wait, what is this?
Bullshit.
Is that from the same email?
So.
What is this stuff? There's something very long after that email. What is this?
I don't see anything.
I'm
in the notes. Are you guys in the notes? Anyways, no. In the meantime, Wrestlefan, I think you have a Mad Mike mail to take care of.
Mad Mike mail.
Yeah.
Let's take a look.
Read it. Fucking read it.
I'm gonna read it. Greetings, Mayhemers. Okay, I can't believe I'm going to say this, but I'm not entirely opposed to the direction that TNA is in right now. I mean, let's look at the facts. There is potential to have a Rude versus Storm feud for the strap. Jeff Hardy isn't in the title picture yet. Sting isn't going to be wrestling, it seems, and is in the de facto role of guy in charge, which I really enjoyed the one Impact they did it. And Hogan is a face, so he won't be bearing any faces now. Also, Velvet is champion, so that's something new and interesting because she won't, or at least shouldn't, be booked as a dominant champion. And Gail Kim is back, so that's something. The only real concern with me for TNA lies, as it almost always does, with Bischoff. It seems like his son of his is going to be a big deal, and I've heard it may even be stretching all the way to lockdown. Mm-hmm. I hope this isn't true, but knowing TNA, it totally is. Granted, how TNA got to some of these points is fucked up and retarded, but I'll take what I can get. However, I will say that if Jeff Hardy ends up with the belt by the end of the year, I'm done with the product. Here is probably the final top 10 list. And yes, lists are still cool when I do them because they're funny. Chachi's not going to say anything? Okay. Top 10 Muppet-related segments to look for on Raw. Number 10, Statler and Waldorf doing guest commentary for the JR and Cole segment. Number 9, Electric Mayhem playing John Cena to the ring.
That would be amazing.
That would be amazing.
That would be awesome.
Electric Mayhem playing anyone to the ring would be amazing.
I want to take a second and point out how kind of sad this email is, because Wrestlefan doesn't know who any of these people are.
I know who most of these people are.
You're too young to know who these Muppets are.
I know the Muppets.
He doesn't know what it's like to download Muppets on dial-up.
Oh, I hate you.
Muppet porn on dial-up.
My childhood.
Oh, Muppet
Number
porn.
8, Zack Ryder confusing Miss Piggy for Vicky Guerrero. Number 7,
God,
Mason Ryan and Kermit singing a duet of It's Not Easy Being Green.
Yes.
Number 6, Johnny Ace being compared to Sam the Eagle. Number 5, Animal somehow scoring a win over John Morrison.
There better be a Swedish chef in here somewhere.
Number 4, the Ninja Turtles showing up in honor of Triple H to exact revenge on Kevin Nash. Number 3, Beth Phoenix and Natalya harassing Janice and Camilla for being chicks. Number 2, Bunsen and Beaker getting blamed for Heath Slater's suspension because of a drug they cooked up. And number 1, Gonzo and Santino as a tag team, both playing air trombones. Hopefully next week I'll have the gear for my eye touch so I can deliver the Mad Mike Minute of Mayhem. That's too many M's. Until then, take care, ginger hair. My alchemist, any transmission. BS, suck it, Bobby.
Oh,
poor Bobby.
I finally got the, after Bobby. All these commercials. Why do you put a commercial in front of the commercial for Raw? This is great.
Kermit the Frog here.
The Muppets guest star on a special Halloween edition of WWE Raw Super Show.
I mean, I can't wait to meet the WWE superstar.
And Divas.
What about the Llama?
You're no Kelly. Kelly.
You're really upset. They're only advertising 3 Muppets so far, really.
What's that?
They're only advertising 3 Muppets for the show so far.
They're only advertising 3 Muppets. They showed a whole bunch of them.
Yeah.
They showed the clips from the movie.
Again, that's a bunch of them.
I know, but it doesn't mean they're going to be on Raw.
Listen, Wrestlefan, shut your mouth. Watch the Muppets. Appreciate it.
Listen,
and moving on.
When WWE advertised that the Muppets are going to be on Raw,
they're not going to fuck around.
Yeah, it's Muppets. Well, you don't get a choice.
I'll hold your word.
The fucking Muppets are going to be on Raw.
No, what is this? Vladimir Kozlov totally looks like Sam the Eagle.
Now shut your infant mouth and let's
shut your infant mouth.
And let's talk about the physical male.
Chachi, did you know Vladimir Kozlov totally looks like Sam the Eagle?
Line of the night, shut your infant mouth.
I'm gonna punch
well
you in
done,
the face.
Chachi, you win.
Right through the internet into Texas. Alright, what do you got there, Chachi? This is physical fan mail.
Physical fan mail.
Physical fan mail
fan
you have
mail.
There.
This physical.
Physical.
This showed
fan
up at my
mail.
Doorstep.
Yes. Sent to kind of the DVD.
They still do physical mail?
It's in there.
We'll get it out.
It's,
wow.
But you wanna play it.
Pull it out, Sorg.
Well, I have to
your teeth.
I have to show them the DVD.
Okay, this will take me a second. Explain.
Sorg sent me a picture of the envelope and a DVD in a case. And I don't know if you read the letter that accompanied...
I didn't. I'll have it for you.
The DVD.
Mm-hmm.
But first, I have to compliment on the handwriting that you can't see because of the white balance.
DVD that said in a pink case that says, well, you gotta put it in there for presentation.
I am. I'm gonna show. This is the picture I got on my cell phone.
Play me.
The DVD, all it says is play me.
Wow.
Now,
play me.
All right. Now, there's several
things. I'm afraid
things.
To see what's on this DVD.
Exactly. There have been several bad moments in movie history with DVDs.
Bobby of J-Town, it's like Saw.
Exactly. Saw or The
no,
Ring.
No, I don't want to play a game.
Yes. So, I mean...
Listen, I'm going to be specifically not looking at the DVD, just in case it's like a Ring type situation.
That's
yeah, I want exactly, a little girl popping out.
That's exactly my point. But anyhow, the letter that accompanies, and this comes from... my new friend, YC Dub. That's what I'm going to call him. We're close like that. It says, "Dear Chachi, if this does not turn you on to indie wrestling, then God help you. This DVD you will pass on to your children," in parentheses, it says Chachettes, "and your children's children, Sorg." I don't understand that part. Yeah.
What?
Wait, so Chachi, you're Sorg's grandpappy?
I guess.
I think we need to explain the lineage here at the show. Enjoy, people are confused.
Enjoy your craps week, YC Dub.
Alright. Alright.
So Sorg's gonna fire this up because I was told that I have to watch at least.
Well, unfortunately, I can't fire it right up because is this it?
It should be. Yeah. I thought you watched it.
No, I told you I didn't watch it.
I thought you put some of it on.
Well, here's the fun part. It's a High Spots DVD, and I don't think I could skip past the commercials here, which are like 3 minutes long.
Commercials?
I don't know. Is this the right thing? Is this what I'm supposed to watch? And isn't that guy the guy from the documentary? What is this?
I know.
Was it a large event?
Is that the Patriot?
Bobcats Arena or a big Coliseum show or even the Park Rec Center at Charlotte.
It was just a small show. It was actually held for somebody's birthday party.
What is this?
What the hell?
This is $5 wrestling.
$5 wrestling.
What the fuck is going on?
Right now, there's probably a card going on at a local arena by your house, and all these companies have champions. Oh, this is the beginning. What if we could send all these champions to one place, much like the Olympics, to represent these companies?
Not much like the Olympics.
Under one
That's
roof.
That's a great green screen. Let me see if I can skip ahead.
And I have won the belt from Charles Schaff. That was the first time I've ever won the title. And I've kept it ever since.
Okay, you say at a church. Was it a wrestling show? I was making sure it was a wrestling show. You said a show.
It was a I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen. It was a wrestling show. It was a wrestling show.
What the hell?
And I beat Charles Schaff. And I won the battle.
This is well over an hour, Chachi.
Aerial battle. Can you top this? Aerial battle.
That was me in fourth grade when I got a little more.
Wait. There's green screen over top.
It's like Mystery Science Theater.
Yeah, you know, maybe a pube show.
Maybe one pube.
One, two. That is just a notch.
Wait, is that Mr. T is a referee?
Are going to get to that next round. I mean, let's hope we've got some oxygen.
Okay. This is a Chachi. Wow. We're gonna have a viewing party.
Wow.
I think we're gonna have a viewing party, and we'll see. We'll do a hangout or something.
That sounds
and
amazing.
Watch this thing.
Wow.
This sounds like a really good idea. And
it's
this is the first
Mystery Science Theater
fan contributed DVD for our consumption. This
wow.
We're gonna have a full report on this.
Listen, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but this just may win. Like, I haven't watched that ghetto wrestling yet, or whatever, the gangster.
Urban championship wrestling.
Yeah, I haven't watched that yet.
Yeah.
Like, I need to, but somehow, I'm just seeing this as...
Mad Mike wants to wait till he comes down to the viewing party.
Wow, because, I can get...
We need to pay to get to see this.
Yeah.
Hey, this is good. I think we need to have a big hangout and watch this.
Wow.
And watch this. And record that.
You know, I'm pretty sure that we can just broadcast this on the internet.
I don't think anybody will mind.
No, not at all.
No. I do like the cropping in the green screen there. Okay, I think that takes all of the fan. I almost forgot. We received a voicemail this week.
No, we didn't.
Jesus Christ. From somebody that went to a wrestling show in San Antonio, Texas, and apparently he had a little bit of a rough start to his evening. Let's check this out.
So, Wrestling Mayhem Show. In case you can tell, this is the one and only Wrestlefan, and I'm here at the AT&T Center preparing for Vengeance, and I started my night off just peachy. Oh, peachy, peachy, peachy keen. Because, oh, silly, silly me, I left my keys in the car and locked the door. So I'm waiting for the locksmith that's supposed to come in 30 minutes to unlock my car. Thanks. Bye.
So, Wrestlefan had a rough start to his night. You okay, Wrestlefan?
I'm embarrassed.
You're the one that called the hotline.
I'm embarrassed.
Ah, let's embarrass you further, Wrestlefan. What's going on in the Indie Minute?
Indie Minute. Well, there's actually two emails that have to deal with the Indie Minute this week. That I'm going to start off with the first one from Your Craps Week, Chachi's best friend, who replies, Super Dragon, clap, 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 Super Dragon, clap, 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 times, I think, like, 50. So what he's talking about is our good friends over at Pro Wrestling Guerrilla, California wrestling company. They had a big event this past weekend entitled Steen Wolf, where Kevin Steen defended the PWG World Championship against El Generico in a ladder match, the first ladder match in pro. Yes, there's all the clapping and the, yeah. First ladder match in PWG history. El Generico coming out the top, being the new PWG champion. However, the big news from the whole night saw the return of Super Dragon, who is pretty much a legend in all of Pro Wrestling Guerrilla and all of California wrestling, who hasn't been wrestled for PWG, I think, in like 4 years now. I want to say he hasn't been in a PWG match in a while. But he made his return, and they announced that at the next event, it was going to be Kevin Steen teaming with Super Dragon to take on the Young Bucks in a guerrilla warfare match, which is basically no time limit, anything goes, hardcore style match, and that's going to be absolutely insane. The tickets are on sale now. I was told that front row tickets for that event are already sold out. So that's very, if you want to get tickets.
Oh, that's the audio.
Whoa. Oh, yeah. I think what Sorg's pulling up is the classic Super Dragon getting in a fan's face for chanting his name too much.
No, that's not it.
It's not. I haven't found it yet.
Oh, well, it's in the chat.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Well, if you're in the California area and you want to go check that out, go to ProWrestlingGuerrilla.com and get your tickets for that event. Should be a great one. The next thing on the Indie Minute is the AON report from one Bobby F. J. Town. Greetings, my nerds. This is the AON report for this week. It appears that the original Florida Thug and Chaos have been selling slightly used merchandise at AON shows. They've even gone as far as stealing the broker's ashes and trying to sell them at their steals and deals table next on to the AON merchandise table. Also, they tried to sell AON color commentator Juice Shannon's daughter at a show as well. Speaking of Juice Shannon, at the end of the Altoona show, it appears that AON's play-by-play commentator Mike Edwards struck Juice Shannon in the face and injured his jaw, putting him in the hospital. I'll have more of an auto massacre recap on next week's AON report. And that is from one Bobby F. J. Town. And the last thing I want to note on the Indie Minute is from ROH News. There is a rumor sort of mill going around that was kind of started on their TV show that Nigel McGuinness may actually be returning to a wrestling ring. He has been doing commentary for the ROH TV show and was involved in sort of a little scuffle in the ring with Truth Martini in the House of Truth with Roderick Strong and Michael Elgin. Nigel McGuinness kind of getting into it with them. Jim Cornette released a statement saying that Nigel McGuinness is not a contracted wrestler for Ring of Honor. He is there to be a color commentator. And right now they have no intentions for him to be in the ring. However, the rumor mill is that there is a chance that we could see the former Ring of Honor world champion Nigel McGuinness back in a wrestling ring for Ring of Honor. That is the Indie news that I have for this week. Welcome back to the Wrestling Mayhem Show. This is the Wrestlefan here, and we are joined right now by our very special guest, promoter of River City Wrestling over in San Antonio, Texas, Brandon Oliver. How are you doing tonight, Brandon?
Good. How are you guys?
Doing good. So we brought you on the show. I mentioned my time over in River City Wrestling the last show that I went to, how great a show it was. Tell us a little bit about River City Wrestling, what you guys are all about, and just a little bit about what you do.
Okay, River City Wrestling, we're San Antonio's brand of professional wrestling. I started it back in 2002 So we've almost been running San Antonio here for 10 years. My background, I was trained at the Shawn Michaels Wrestling Academy, and that's where I got my start. He had a promotion called the Texas Wrestling Alliance. And then when that closed towards the tail end of 2000, I kind of just went around different Texas indie promotions, doing anything I could, refereeing, managing, commentating, just anything to get my foot in the door. And then, like I said, 2002 opened RCW because really there wasn't anything going on as far as, you know, solid independent wrestling promotions in San Antonio. A lot of them were fly-by-nights or just real, not very dependable. So, you know, we opened RCW in 2002 and things really started taking shape in 2005. And I mean, we draw great crowds. I mean, for independents, we usually average about 300 or so a show. And we brought down plenty of names, you know, veterans that you may know, like Mick Foley and Marty Jannetty, WWE Hall of Famer Sonny. We've had the great Muda from Japan. And then we've had some guys from, you know, that have pretty much got their start with RCW, such as Hernandez now in TNA, and Lance Hoyt that was in TNA and WWE, and now he's in New Japan Pro Wrestling, you know, get their starts with RCW. We have a lot of great young talent as well that have also had lots of tryouts with WWE and TNA. So, and like I said, we've really brought an awareness to wrestling here in San Antonio, especially because it was such a big wrestling town. I know growing up here, I mean, you had World Class and you had Southwest mm-hmm. Championship, you know, back in the 80s, back in the territorial days, you know, Jose Lothario and everybody, you know, down at the Coliseum. And I mean, it was a shame that it kind of fell into the doldrums for a little bit. But I think RCW has really brought that awareness back.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, for example, I grew up in Corpus and there's not a lot of major promotions in Texas, which is why I think for you guys, I mean, you've been there for so long and you've made a really stable or a consistent crowd. I think it's really great what you guys are doing. You mentioned your training over at the Shawn Michaels Wrestling Academy. I'm assuming that you're a big fan of professional wrestling. Can I ask what kind of really got you into, you know, the world of professional wrestling?
Well, yeah, just like anything else, you know, you're inspired from somewhere. And I mean, I started out as a wrestling fan when I was 6 years old and, you know, watched it religiously and followed it religiously. And, you know, I was one of those nerds in high school that, you know, followed wrestling hardcore, you know, but, you know, when everybody else was afraid to say they were wrestling fans in high school. But I mean, this was a different era, you know, before like NWO and Stone Cold and everybody made wrestling popular again. But, you know, it really enhanced when I moved to Tampa, Florida, and I've never realized what a hotbed Tampa is for wrestlers that were, you know, big in the 80s and 90s. I mean, if you name a guy, they pretty much have lived in Tampa at one point or another. And that's where I got to be introduced into the actual inner workings of the business. You know, finding out about wrestling schools and talking to different wrestlers there. And then in 1999, I had an opportunity to go to college here in Texas. And at that same time, Shawn Michaels opened the Wrestling Academy. And I was like, okay, it's meant to be. So I packed up everything and moved from Tampa, Florida, back to San Antonio.
Very cool. One thing I want to know, and the one thing, because I went to the Battle Lines 5 event that you guys had back in October. The one thing that I loved the most, I think, about your show is that, and, you know, people criticize the WWE about having a PG product. I think you guys really do have the perfect mix of, you know, the wrestling that everyone loves mixed with the characters that can really, you know, it's a very family-friendly show that you guys put on to a certain degree. What do you think about that whole ideal that WWE is implementing with the whole going almost completely PG as opposed to some of their older tactics?
Well, I mean, wrestling is a business like no other. You know, what's going to work for them is what's going to meet the bottom line, so to speak. And, you know, WWE feels like, at least in my opinion, seems to be that they feel like if they approach that kind of direction, then, you know, that will appease their sponsors and, you know, the families and the corporations, you know, and I can't deny that. I mean, if it's, if it's making them profitable, that's the name of business, you know. You know, as far as RCW, as far as what I can actually control, because I can't control WWE. Mm-hmm. But, you know, as far as what I could control, you know, being that I only run one city, I believe in a territory system. Like you said, Corpus, and we actually work with a promotion down in Corpus. But yeah, I mean, I only believe in territories. So, you know, if I'm just going to promote San Antonio, I can't go after a niche audience, you know, just by doing hardcore and, right. You know, like stuff that's geared towards young men and their, you know, teens and 20s, you know, because I'm going to find myself a very, very small audience, you know, because those guys, you know, that's what appeals to them. But what I got to sit there and do is find something that appeals to everybody, you know. Right. Maybe there'll be something that appeals to them, but also maybe something appeals to the kids and maybe something appeals to the family. So that way, you know, I could draw everybody from the community, not just one certain audience, you know.
Definitely, yeah. I really do love the mix of, I mean, you have the guys like Ray Rowe, who we actually talked to on the show before, and guys like Quentin Allen and stuff like that, who are, you know, really amazing wrestlers, and mixed with the guy, the people like, you know, the Andromedas, the Honky Kongs, that have grown actually a large fan base in your company. I really do love just that aspect of the whole thing, that you go to different audiences and not just stick with one sort of realm.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you're talking very big extremes there, you know, where you said, you know, Roe and Quentin Allen are just, you know, badass athletes. And then you got Honky Kong, who I would consider completely family friendly. And then you have someone like Andromeda, who is just over the top, exaggerated, exotico. You know, I mean, for those that don't know what an exotico is in Lucha Libre lore, you know, it's a transsexual character, you know, and, you know, we even, you know, refer to Andromeda as a she. So, you know, but it's funny because out of the most popular wrestlers in RCW, Andromeda is right up there. The audience goes nuts when he comes out because he's so larger in life. And he doesn't go for just the easy, you know, the kind of easy comedy, so to speak. You know, there's a very psychological aspect to the Andromeda, you know, makeup.
Absolutely, yeah. Next thing I want to talk about is you guys, I actually looked this up. You guys have a RCW wrestling gym and sort of a training school, I guess. You want to tell us a little bit about what you guys do over there?
Yeah, we've only ran the gym for the past year. In the past, we've tried wrestling schools, but what we were getting was a lot of fans, and nothing wrong with that at all, because without fans, there'd be no wrestling. But, you know, right. it takes a certain kind to be in professional wrestling, especially the long, hard road that there is. I mean, I like to say that RCW is the best promotion in San Antonio. I have pride in my product, but you know, there's a lot of RCWs and, you know, all over the country. So, you know, it's a very long, hard road. And so we kind of stopped running a school for a while just because, like I said, we were getting fans, you know, and let's face it, WWE wants guys in their 20s that are, you know, 6'4" and jacked to the gills, you know, that's what's going to get people into WWE. And really, there's not a whole lot of places a wrestler can make a living, except for WWE, TNA, and a couple other places. Right. So, you know, but last year, you know, we wanted a place to call our own and train and stuff like that. So I opened up a gym, and actually Honky Kong is one of the guys that has gone through the RCW gym. And, you know, so we've started training wrestlers around here locally. It's not very expensive. I mean, I know a lot of wrestling schools charge an arm and a leg. You know, you have to go out and steal a car and go sell it in order to be in a wrestling school. But, you know, ours isn't, you know, because I mean, I'll straight up tell a guy if he, you know, has it or doesn't have it, you know, right. And, I don't want to waste his time. I don't want to waste anybody's money, you know, that's not what RCW is about. I mean, you know, but I mean, if a guy comes in there and he shows he has the passion for it and really wants to do this, then yeah, you know, well, I won't charge him much, you know, come in and we could train them, you know.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, and you mentioned earlier, guys like Hernandez that's gone to TNA and Lance Hoyt that's been in WWE and TNA. Actually, former RCW World Champion Gerard St. Christopher was at the Vengeance pay-per-view this past Sunday as Cody Rhodes' bagger. So it just kind of shows, right, like, the influence, I think, that you guys have, you know, if people want to, you know, make wrestling a living and maybe get to WWE and TNA.
Well, Gerard, he actually was trained with Killer Kowalski, and then he went to Lance Storm School.
Yeah.
So Gerard's actually had a pretty solid background, and he's really gonna had a chance to go out there and, you know, get those WWE tryouts and those, you know, little spots where, you know, he's security or Cody Rhodes' bag boy or whatever, you know. So that's awesome.
Mm-hmm. Here's a question I was really thinking about. We only talked to a few promoters here on the show. What would you say is probably the best parts and the worst parts of being a pro wrestling promoter?
The best parts, I mean, I'll tackle the best part at the end. The worst parts, I mean, it almost seems almost daily up until the show. you know, I have sacrificed a tremendous amount of time and money. I mean, I have a family, you know, and, you know, everything that they've been through, and, you know, I've lost friendships and relationships, and, you know, it's made me suffer in other areas of my life. You know, having said that, the best parts, you know, is when the show happens and when it all comes together, when the guys in the back give their 100% and the crowd loves it. And, you know, the crowd is at the very end of the show telling me what a great time that they had and stuff. That's what makes it all worth it. Even if it's just that small amount of time, it makes it all worth it. I mean, it takes me back to when I was 6 years old, back when I believed in everything about wrestling. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if I can inspire that, that's what makes it worth it. You know, because, yeah, there's plenty of times where you're just like, you know what, you know, it's too much. You know what I mean? It's just, you know, it's not worth it. But then when that happens, it's like, okay. You know, and like I said, I've been doing this for 10 years. I mean, just RCW.
Right.
You know, I've been in the business a little bit longer than that. But, you know, and like I said, I mean, I could have paid off quite a few loans, you know, with the money that I've spent on professional wrestling. But like I said, it's at the end of the day, when those fans are smiling and happy, you know, it's like, wow, that's awesome. I mean, I've seen RCW shirts at WWE events, and I'm not just talking about San Antonio. They've sent me pictures where they're at like a Ring of Honor event or a WWE mm-hmm. event somewhere else in another state with an RCW shirt. And I'm like, wow, that's cool. You know what I mean? I mean, that really is awesome, you know? So, and of course the relationships you make in wrestling too. I mean, you know, the bonds that you make and the stories that come out of it, it's really cool.
Very cool. Let's go talk about what you guys are doing now with RCW. It was actually announced quite a couple days, maybe a couple days ago. You have a new partnership, RCW, with Good Job Texas. What is that all about?
Yeah, well, Good Job Texas, they're a new radio station here in San Antonio. Right now they're doing digital HD broadcasts and doing like the live streaming over their internet. And they have a community radio station, and they're also wanting to do a lot of video projects and things like that. And basically what they're doing is they're spotlighting a lot of local artists here in San Antonio, independent artists, which is awesome. I mean, you know, as you know, thanks to, you know, things like this and these guys, I mean, you know, there's a lot of other avenues for people to express, you know, what they want to express without corporate radio, mm-hmm. you know, and that's what it's all about. I mean, you know, corporate radio is just so rigid and confined. I mean, you know, versus vehicles like this, it's awesome. And that's what Good Job Texas is about too. You know, it's a bunch of, you know, young guys, very innovative minds that are willing to go on the community and push this thing as far as they can go. And RCW is glad to you know, go along with that. Everywhere they're going to be, we're going to be, and vice versa. So mm-hmm. it's quite a partnership, and I think it's going to be very exciting. Lots of, you know, grassroots type stuff, which I really enjoy doing.
Mm-hmm. Very cool. And go ahead.
I was going to say on that point. Now, a lot of promotions, you see around the area. Like I said, there's a lot of fly by night stuff, but not a lot that present themselves as a company. I see a lot of partnerships on your website since WrestleFan's been telling us about it down there, and I noticed that you're an LLC, which I don't see that too often in wrestling companies.
It's funny how wrestling is, because wrestling, attracts all different kind of people, of all different walks of life. My background, is marketing and promotions and public relations and media. So, and I'm not just saying that, as like a hobby. That's actually my day job every day. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I wanted to really establish was, I learned very early about the fly-by-nights and what burns fans, because quite honestly, in my opinion, I think a lot of fans out there are just like, the heck with the indies. I'm just going to go to WWE, because any night of the week, on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. I mean, it seems like almost every night of the week from the comfort of the living room, they can watch the best in the world on TV for free, and I'm talking about WWE, TNA, Ring of Honor and all that. And that's very hard to compete with, to sit there and say, okay, Joe Q, wrestling fan, get in your car. Well, load up your family, get in the car, drive to some, venue that you don't really know, because it's not going to be the top venue of the city, obviously. Mm-hmm. And, fork over $10 each or whatever the cost of the ticket is. And, and see the majority of wrestlers you've never seen before, as much as I love them. And how much effort they get, but I mean, most indie wrestlers, nobody's ever heard of. That's a hard sell. That is a very, very, very hard sell, because, why are you going to go through all that when you could just watch Triple H and John Cena and The Undertaker for free? And when they go to these fly by nights and, or these, glorified backyard promotions, it puts a sour taste in their mouth. They're like, wow, I could beat that guy's ass, or, or that guy doesn't look like a wrestler, or, I mean? Like, they're like, I paid $10 for this, and that's the sour taste that they get. And they're going to just sit there and say, I'm just going to save my money and watch WWE for free, except for the pay-per-view or whatever.
Right.
And that's a hard sell, It's rough. It's a rough economy. It's, rough for people right now, and you got to motivate them. So, I learned that very, very, very quickly. And one of the things I wanted to present was, this is a professional company. This is an LLC. I went out and made relationships with the media here, because I didn't want to be presented as, a wrestling fan that happened to get a ring and threw it up in the backyard.
Right.
I wanted to present this as a legitimate company, as, pay your taxes, get all the right licenses get all the right things. I mean, that's what you got to do,
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And may I just say personally, from the show that I went to, trust me, you do a great job of, being a very presentable company. It was very high notch for the whole setup at the show. So let's talk about, you got an event coming up, November 5th, for Return to Glory 4. Tell us a little bit about what's going to go on that night.
All right. November 5th at the Good Shepherd Lutheran Church. Come on. It's wrestling at a church. How great is that? But at the Good Shepherd Lutheran Church here in San Antonio, 8 p.m. on November 5th. What we got is, we're going to have RCW champion Ray Rowe, who you guys are familiar with. He'll be in action, probably beating somebody's ass. We got from TNA, Supermax Hernandez. Like I said, he is the RCW icon. I've known Hernandez since 1999. Him and I just go way back, and he's pretty much the backbone of RCW. But there's a little thing going on between Hernandez and Ray Rowe concerning Ray Rowe's wife. Hernandez is kind of a ladies' man,
Yeah,
I don't know if Ray Rowe really appreciates it that much.
Very intriguing as to what's going to come from that.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about two big, bald, you know, badasses that, you know, I mean, one guy's, you know, flirting with the other dude's wife. I don't think, you know, a bald guy's buff with tattoos is going to take very kindly to that. You know what I mean? We also got from WCW days, Gorgeous George, Macho Man Randy Savage's, you know, ex-girlfriend back in the 90s. She's going to be there as well. You know, we got the tag titles on the line. We got the international title on the line. Andromeda, as I mentioned, defending an international title against the Minister Rick David. And that's a true culture clash. I mean, you have a religious zealot in the Minister Rick David, and then you got a, you know, a flamboyant El Mamacito Andromeda. You know, it's very two different beliefs. So
another interesting part of you being held at the Good Shepherd Lutheran Church. I was surprised at how many people booing Rick David in that venue.
I love it. See, that's the beauty of wrestling is we have wrestling at a church, and one of the top bad guys is a religious guy.
Exactly.
So,
yeah.
You know, I mean, and one of the top good guys in a church is a transsexual, which is awesome.
And on top of that, don't you guys have like completely intergender matches as we were seeing in some of the footage too?
Yeah. So yeah, why not? You know, what this all started was last year. We have this one guy named Joey Spector who is this little hairy runt of a guy. The guy looks like he wears a pair of pants. You know, when he wears his trunks, you know what I mean? He's that hairy.
He's very hairy.
Yeah. Yeah. It's gross. Anyway, but you know, he did this whole male chauvinist, you know, women don't belong in wrestling type thing. And, you know, he was being down on Sonny and being down on, you know, various, you know, women wrestlers and stuff. So, Alyssa Flash from TNA came in. And if you're familiar with Alyssa Flash or cheerleader Melissa, she's also known as the female Terminator. I mean, she's tough as hell, man. I mean, she could beat up most dudes. And so she came in and fought Joey Spector for the RCW championship. And I tell you, when she pinned Joey Spector, we had like 400 people there. And when she pinned him, I mean, the place just erupted. It was huge, mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah, I saw that. That was the one thing I think I think what gave you a lot of media coverage was, I mean, I think that was the first case where a female has held a top wrestling promotion's, you know, heavyweight title.
Yeah. I mean, the only other woman I could think of was China when she held the Intercontinental title in WWE. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure somewhere out in the great vast indie, you know, universe, there may have been a female that held the promotion's top title. But as far as I know, no promotion has had its top champion a female. So that was awesome. And Alyssa Flash is fantastic. I mean, you know, all of her moves that she does, and then she does one where, you know, she picks up a dude like in a wheelbarrow position outside the ring and just starts slinging him through all the chairs. You know what I mean? It's awesome. Especially when she was doing it to Spectre. It was fantastic.
Definitely. Yeah. And I love the fact that you guys are an intergender company. You have the ones like Raina Pink and Darcy Drake. I think I mentioned this before. You would think when a man fights a woman, it's sort of a different looking sort of match, but they fight, you know, as well as the men do, and they do a great job at it.
Yeah, and they look great doing it too. I mean, exactly. Darcy Drake, you know, belongs, you know, at another level. I mean, her look alone is fantastic. I mean, absolutely. You know, you talk about all the divas and stuff, and I think she's up there.
Definitely. Well, thanks for coming on, Brandon. Fans want to go check you guys out, where can they go to?
Then go to our website, rcw-wrestling.com. You know, that's got the links to our Facebook and all that, to our YouTube videos, which I wanted to say are very crazy if you've ever watched them. I mean, if you ever look through, I mean, we've had everything from a Karate Kid remake to swirlies. Alyssa Flash gave this one girl a swirly, and I mean, the water just hits her right in the face. I mean, just all sorts of crazy YouTube videos. Like I mentioned, Spectre, you know, was filming a promo out by his pool. And, you know, when you dive into a pool, especially as guys, you know, we typically kind of, you know, the trunks kind of sag down a little bit when you dive in.
Oh, God.
Well, you know, Spectre's climbing out of the pool and, you know, he's trying to do like one of those 10 type things, you know what I mean? Where the girl comes out and does her hair like that, you know what I mean? She's trying to look sexy. Well, he does the same thing, except his trunks are like halfway down his ass and he's got like all that hair.
I've seen the videos. Spectre's had a couple moments where it's
he has had some fantastic moments. But if you go to that YouTube, I mean, seriously, it's really, really entertaining. Some of the crazy videos that we've done. But again, RCW-wrestling.com. That's where you can go check it out.
And he mentioned, definitely go to November 5th at the Good Shepherd Lutheran Church. I will be there, as well as Brandon and all the great RCW talent.
Definitely. We're going to tear it up that night.
Definitely. Thanks for coming on, Brandon.
All right. Thank you guys very much.
All right. Thanks. Thanks, Brandon, for joining us. Here's a little bit of what's going to happen in Gold. We'll be right back, guys.
The Bushwhackers had a school. They had a restaurant, a Bushwhackers restaurant.
Nice.
Coincidentally, it ended up closing, you know, like a year or two later.
Most of the time, we think here.
Probably
I don't know how to describe what it is I take. I take a lot of commas.
Hi guys, welcome back. I hope you loved that interview. Right now, we like to do a nice little show. Segment we like to call. Remember when?
I do.
So, when you're a little kid, do you remember watching shows like, Guts,
The Aggro Craig.
What else? What would you do? Double Dare.
All that.
Legends of the Hidden Temple. Yes. All those fun little games.
Yeah. Finders Keepers. Nick Arcade.
Finders Keepers.
Oh, man. I always wanted to go on Nick Arcade.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Nick Arcade. I forgot about Nick Arcade. Mm-hmm. But in 1983, a certain show was on very popular back in the day. And his name, it was Bozo the Clown.
Yeah.
And there happened to be a little 8-year-old boy that wanted to be on the Bozo the Clown show. And I think we got a video to see who that little 8-year-old boy was.
I got a letter and some video from a Chicago public school teacher named Chris Kowalski. And she says, I am the aunt of WWE professional wrestler CM Punk, a.k.a. Phil Brooks. In 1986, my family finally got the chance to go down to the Bozo show after waiting 10 years for tickets. I was 19 and my nephews, Michael and Philip, were 10 and 8. Anyway, Phil was chosen to play the game at the end of the show. Not only did Phil win the game, this is CM Punk, Phil.
Yeah.
But he exhibited what will be his trademark humor and cockiness. I think he was destined for the world of the WWE. Okay, this is what the wrestler CM Punk looks like now.
Nice ROH picture.
Here he is on the old Bozo show back in 1986. CM Punk is the boy who is to the right of Joey DeOrio. Take a look.
When the music stops, it's eliminated. You got it? So you don't want to be wearing this when the music stops. Huh? That's good. I'll do the jokes, okay?
I think that was Punk there.
Yeah.
Bozo, I think your son is here. Anyway, go.
Are you? So I think that's him in the middle.
I don't know.
Yeah, he's the one.
Yeah, he's the one in the orange.
And Joey is Bozo, so I think he was the kid to the right of the other guy.
It's coming up here.
They don't even know.
Yeah, they don't even know.
He's the kid that wins.
There he is, the kid that won right there. That's CM Punk.
Ladies and gentlemen, the comedian is our winner right here.
He really looks like him.
It's you.
Well, I hope so.
Yeah. There you go. Okay.
He's as well dressed as I was.
Okay.
He won a new and exciting game from Parker Brothers called Don't Wake the Dragon.
Oh, shit.
Oh, hell yeah.
Don't wake the dragon.
By the makers of Uno. You know what it's called?
No, what's it called?
Luck
plus. Oh, and it's for the other players. What do you think of that?
Kids right. Watch this.
Wait, there's
yes.
More.
Yes.
Everyone is going to get a look at this. What is it? It's a brand new shampoo. It's called Created. It's for kids.
Give the Bozo video. Give
a Crayola shampoo.
Wow. Wow, we need to have prizes on the Wrestling Mayhem show like that.
There you go. Crayola shampoo.
Crayola
nice.
Shampoo.
The dragon.
Nice find, Rizz.
Yeah, nice. Welcome. Nice.
You're welcome.
Memory via YouTube.
Yeah.
That's fine.
I was a fetus back then.
A little bit.
Wrestlefan's age.
So we had a question that came in over the line. DJ Launchbox?
Yes, that's true. It came in over the line of me. I have a question for the assembled panel here of the Mayhem Show, and also you listening at home in the chat room, and also you know on the podcast. I find myself in an interesting situation. One I know a lot of guys often hope to find themselves in. I have a lady friend. That's not all.
I have lots of lady friends.
She's interested in. She knows I love professional wrestling. She knows I do the Mayhem Show. It's a bit. She knows it's a big part of my life, and she's interested in getting into wrestling. She wants to know why I like it. She doesn't want just some casual introduction, some fucking random wrestling. She wants to know what is it that's so appealing to us. Why do we love it so much? My question to the panel is, where do I start? I have a couple of matches in mind to show her. Like, I want to show her, like, Undertaker Sean 1. I want to show her Macho Man versus Ricky the Dragon Steamboats. I want her to understand what it is about wrestling that we really like and why we watch the things that we do and, you know, ignore the stuff we don't so much like. I am looking for recommendations. Gentlemen.
Well,
$5 wrestling.
$5 wrestling. no, I think the obvious choice is definitely Stranglemania Volume 1 shown here. I think anything captures the essence. That's it.
Mm. Well, see, I find myself in a similar predicament, Senor Lunchbox.
Excellent.
And what I've taken to, because I haven't actually forced her to watch any of the wrestling.
You don't want to force feed the wrestling.
Yeah, so, I mean, what I find myself doing is explaining things that have happened in the wrestling leading up to the current event that I'm watching.
Yeah.
Like, at the time I've started, it was right after the pay-per-view where CM Punk won the belt and then left the company.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so I had explained all of that to her. And then I was showing her tweets that he was sending out, like the belt in the fridge and stuff like that. To the point where now, last night, in fact, I had fallen asleep during Raw. And I woke up to text messages from her stating that CM Punk is her favorite wrestler. Letting me know that CM Punk made Back to the Future references. And that was why he's her favorite wrestler.
And it's going to appeal. It's going to be depend on the appeal. And I think I think your process is the best because it's not just I think you want to show classic matches that are in your mind are the greatest. But help me out, LB. When you think of these matches that you want to show her, are they not matches that you kind of saw the build up for, so you know how significant they are?
That's true. That presents a bit of a problem. I can't show and explain to her like, oh, okay, so Shawn Michaels got the best of The Undertaker and nobody gets the best of The Undertaker. And, you know, I mean, she's not going to care about that. She's not going to care about that.
Well, exactly. I mean, what you need to do is you need to build it up yourself. Like, pick an individual character like I did with CM Punk, who at the time and still is doing things that I find highly entertaining.
Somebody you enjoy and explain why am I a fan of that? Like, who's somebody that would stick out in your mind to share like that?
Like right now.
Right now, that? In the past.
Like right now.
Right now? Or, I have to agree. I do think CM Punk is doing spectacular work.
And the other kind of side of this is to present with say, you know, if you're like, this is why Stone Cold was the greatest, get a copy of, like, you know, the Austin versus McMahon tape or something like that. You can borrow and I think that does something to that. You see the progression. You know what I mean? You see the spots going through. It's not just like, look at this. Look what you did with the beer truck. You know, wasn't this a great moment? Yes, it was a great moment at the time.
Yeah, every but time they we, don't know
exactly.
That.
But every time we see it, we know what went around that.
Mm-hmm.
It's more meaningful to us than to the casual fan that just sees it, you know, by itself, like in the OMG moments or something like that.
The
OMG moments from the time that I wasn't watching wrestling mean less to me than when I was watching wrestling.
Right.
So
I think what you need to do is kind of a combination of both what Sorg and I are saying.
Mm-hmm.
Don't pick a classic match like you were going to do. Find a DVD set.
Mm-hmm.
Like, ironically enough, the Bret Hart Shawn Michaels one that's coming out,
mm-hmm.
where they show the lead up and then they show the screw job. And
that might be a little too much behind the curtain, though.
Yeah, that's a lot of inside baseball to introduce her to. Yeah.
Like what Mad Mike was talking about.
I like what you're saying, though. I do have one of the matches I wanted to show her was Bret Hart versus Steve Austin, that incredible I Quit match that they had. And I have the Bret Hart DVD, which has, you know, the background and the lead up to that. So I think that might be a good step in the right direction.
What are you saying, Riz?
But yeah, like what Mad Mike was talking about, get the Macho Man's DVD set. They tell you everything that happened from the last match that you saw to the match that's coming up. So you have that history. Netflix. Yeah, it's on Netflix.
Is it now? Cool.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Okay. I got to see Macho Man versus Bruno Sammartino, which was ridiculous.
As a Yuki guy, yeah, I mean, you know, don't pick something like, don't show the entire three discs of a Macho Man.
No.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even show her that match because I like that match because I'm a hardcore wrestling fan.
Yeah, and it's
casual observer. They're like, this is fucking boring.
Yeah, it's Macho Man versus Bruno Sammartino. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. like, that means something to you. To a non-wrestling fan, that means dick.
And you're somebody that's a variety. Like, when you've introduced her to somebody like CM Punk or Macho Man, and you're like, and this is something different. Show her a little bit of, like, you, I know you were a big fan of old Samoa Joe Ring of Honor stuff, and you have a couple of discs. Like, and this is why I like this guy. And you know, introduce her to the different types of wrestling, you know?
That was another thing I had in mind, was showing her all the different styles. I mean, you guys know I'm a hardcore wrestling fan, so I'm going to break out, you know, old ECW and things like that.
Mm-hmm. But or toss in the Forever Hardcore DVD or something like that. You know, this is why it was important, you know? And this is them explaining why it's important. This is the Monday Night Wars. This is why this was important. You know, I think those documentary DVDs might be the best thing to kind of narrow it down a little bit. And also, I think look at, for fun, throw in something crazy like Kaiju Big Battle.
Yeah.
You know, if you think I'm taking this, and this too seriously, look at this. Mm-hmm. Or Chikara. Exactly. Chikara. I mean, Chikara, I think, is a great kind of middle ground for a lot of people.
And I also have, I want to show her the really big stuff like the WWE and maybe some WCW, the hardcore like ECW. I also have some IWC DVDs I mean, I was there. I know the match is good.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Get down, kid.
And then if you want to introduce her in person, those indie shows are the best. Seriously. I think when a new person goes to a WWE show, it's too big. It's just far too big. And you're so far away from everything. But if you go to an indie show, you know how those are. You know how kind of visceral they are in comparison. I mean, you know, go to your first indie show and it's a whole other experience.
As much as I hate to say it, it is a lot. It's in that vein a lot like NASCAR. It's a totally different experience when you're there in the arena.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, and some people may like it more because of that. And that feeling they get in person versus the other way. Does this help a bit, sir?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think it's great. And I also, I mean, like I said, I encourage our listeners to email in goodtimes@wrestlingmayhemshow.com. How? Do you have a lady friend that's into wrestling? How did you get her into wrestling? I welcome your advice.
It's also, like, I don't mean to go back to the conversation and everything, because you guys were trying to get out of it. But it's also it's also one of those things that may just happen with time.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, yeah, because, I mean, chances are, if you hang out a lot, it's going to happen when a wrestling show is on.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to want to watch that wrestling
show. It's
going
to be a, ooh, what's this?
Yeah.
And then there's some stuff from the chat room. Mike actually says, to show her Raw when the Muppets are on.
That's a great idea.
Yeah. Mike also says his ex got into wrestling by showing up when he was watching SmackDown once and she thought Eddie was hot. Then she started watching it. You know, that's another way, you know, her type of guy may be in there. I don't know.
Well, YC-Dub lost his virginity watching SmackDown.
Nice.
Hot damn.
Wow. Mm. Subliminal coercion, says Sonic Screwjob. So there you go. Now, there's some pictures floating around in the chat room, guys. What is going on here at WrestleFest?
I have no idea
I turned him down because he was typing too loud.
There are new Knockout Halloween pictures.
Yeah.
Some of them are hot. There's, you know, Velvet Sky is always, you know, really awesome as Freddy Krueger.
Yeah.
But they also have Sarita as Freddy Krueger, and
they went a different direction with this.
I think we had this discussion during Valentine's Day one year.
Like, I think
Tara had the chocolate all over her face.
Yeah, and it was just weird.
It just
This is like the chocolate over the face, except it's herpes.
No, not
entirely.
No, it's not herpes. Well,
I know it's not herpes, but I'm sorry, that looks like herpes.
No, it doesn't.
It
doesn't look anything like herpes.
Are you familiar with what herpes is?
It doesn't look attractive.
Now this
is—it's Freddy Krueger. It's not supposed to.
What about that?
Look at Velvet Sky is Freddy Krueger.
Yeah,
because she's not all painted up. That's why.
Yeah, her Freddy Krueger sucks in comparison because that's not Freddy Krueger.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
It's hot chick with a claw.
You know what? Go to bed.
You shouldn't be looking at these pictures, anyways. You know how long these pictures would have loaded on the modem.
Go to bed.
Just saying.
On a modem, you would have had, like, the patience to see maybe four of them.
Yeah.
And you wouldn't have had the fucking hard drive space to save more than three.
That's right.
Word.
That's right. What was my first hard drive I ever had? 130 megabytes.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Wrestling!
Yeah! Hey. All right, what else is going on? There was a pay-per-view Sunday, which most of us watched here, I think.
There's a freaking sweet pay-per-view Sunday.
Chachi, you think it's freaking sweet?
I mean, it was better than the one before.
All right, WWE Vengeance, the big thing. How do you
do? Really? I thought you loved the last pay-per-view, Chachi.
How do you do a main event without a proper ring?
What was the last pay-per-view?
Hell in the Cell.
No.
Calm it down.
Yeah.
Was it?
You yelled at me because I didn't like the Sin Cara match. You said I was shitting on the pay-per-view.
Easy. Don't rehash it.
It's been a long 2 weeks. So, all right. Yeah, no, it was, you're right. I rescind my past statement.
So
it was not better than Hell in the Cell.
How do you do? It's not better than Hell in the Cell?
No. Hell in the Cell was sweet.
But we had a collapsed ring.
Again.
We had a
which Riz and I
ring.
Called.
I was thinking about it like a week ago. I'm like, this match needs like a this feud needs something to happen.
Well,
it's bound to happen one day. I was like,
well, number one, you have to take in the 7-year rule,
mm-hmm. which you called out immediately after it started.
Well, I mean, I'm like, this ring is gonna collapse.
Yeah, well, because that's the thing. Like right after the Orton Rhodes match, because I was at the pay per view, the like droids guys or whatever were like doing something
droids.
With the aprons,
yeah.
And I'm like, what the hell are they doing? I'm like, and then the thing, I'm like, oh, okay, they were setting up the ring to collapse.
But I mean, well, think about it. Brock Lesnar is 300 pounds
mm-hmm.
tops,
yeah. mm-hmm.
and Big Show is 500. At least that's what they bill him at.
I think he's down to like 480 or something.
Yeah. So, still, I mean, half a ton of guy in the ring.
Half?
No, seriously.
Half a ton of guy.
500 plus 500 is 1,000 plus what the referee weighs. So that's over half a ton of man.
The referee's a factor in this.
Wait, no, he's not at all. But
yeah. Little bit of it.
But yeah.
The
so
reason Big Show was crying the whole match was because he couldn't beat him.
So if Brock Lesnar superplexes Big Show and the ring collapses, then Big Show superplexing Mark Henry has to break the fucking ring.
Mm.
That's all there is to
pretty
it.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it was easy to call.
And yeah, that doesn't mean it wasn't awesome.
No, I'm not saying that at all. Anytime they decide to collapse the ring, it's pretty fucking sweet.
And then have one more match in that broken ring.
That's the whole comment was, how the fuck are they going to do the last match?
And they pulled it off.
That's all they said on the announcer side, too. They're like, how are they going to fight in the broken ring?
It's kind of like, remember Royal Rumble several years ago? They, for some strange reason, had the Royal Rumble as not the last match. Our last match was Undertaker versus Kurt Angle. And what happened at the end? Did the ring catch on fire or something? Basically, something happened to the ring that they wouldn't be able to use anymore.
I remember that.
And it was so obvious. It was like, oh, it's the last match. That's why they did it, because they're doing this crazy thing.
Yeah.
And you know, so you don't expect that. You're like, okay, they could do something like that, right? But it's the next to last match with a main event still to come. They're not going to do something like this. That's what really, I think, shocked people.
Yeah.
At least the smart marks out there.
It worked out, though.
Oh, it was great.
I mean, the last match was awesome.
It was a fantastic moment, and the last match was great. It was the last man standing, so I didn't require a full ring.
Right.
And they got to do some interesting things around that.
Yeah. I wasn't happy.
That's the whole thing. And there was a debate going on Twitter about how the match... Someone thought the match sucked because it's a spot fest and blah, blah, blah. That's what a last man standing match is.
Pretty much, right?
Yeah, that's the point of it. It's supposed to be brutal.
It's everyone's one-upping the next guy. No. Oh, what can I do to this guy?
We're in a last man standing match, and we're still mad because John Cena's like hitting people with stuff plus his five moves of doom. I'm sorry. That's not... No,
listen,
no.
Listen, you're not going to call out my man Bo Diggity.
Because I know
that's who you're talking about.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
But he is well aware that a last man standing match is a spot fest.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So
what more do you want to
have? Yeah, but I mean, some of the spots were just...
They're pretty good. And they're different, and they're inventive, and I mean...
Like when John Cena tried to push a freaking... whatever that giant-ass thing was that he tried to kill Del Rio with in the back.
Actually, no, Del Rio did that.
No, it was...
No, Cena shoved the thing, but Del Rio moved out of the way.
Okay, first off...
And then they went to the interview section, and he kept tearing down those metal, like, things in the background and piling them on Cena.
You're right.
First off, that was a sound equipment dolly.
Okay, I didn't know what to call it.
Look at you.
But,
look at you.
And secondly, it was Cena. He tried to push it on top and missed, and at which point Del Rio destroyed the entire pre-match interview set and dropped every piece of fencing on him.
The whole time I'm yelling at him, take the sandbags off the set piece. It'll be easier.
That's why there's
my God.
To push over. See,
you're a stupid Mexican.
Hey,
but, there's racism.
Yeah, but the whole time...
They're practically in Mexico, hey.
The whole time Del Rio is tearing those things off the set, I'm like, all right, this is going to be the part where Super Cena shows up and just, like, goes into an Incredible Hulk type rage and just rises up.
Rises
up through...
Rises from the grave.
No, rises up. And, like, as he stands up, all those pieces just fall off of him. But they completely missed that opportunity, and he crawled out from under them. But
can I just point out that, like, not that long ago, Del Rio was nobody. Mm-hmm. Like, we had no clue who he was. He was just some guy who got introduced. He's done so fucking well for himself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is a guy that
did a whole lot for himself previously. And as opposed to coming from the indies, he's somebody they brought in from basically the WWE of Mexico, as I understand it. So yeah. It's not like this guy kind of came at, you're from the indies, whatever. We don't really think what you did was important in Ring of Honor, like most people, versus, okay, you were the Hulk Hogan down there, and we're doing it here.
He's,
you know,
I mean,
that's not a one-to-one. I know there's a lot more to that. But, I mean, that's the concept, right? Yeah. I mean, this guy was proven in Mexico. That's a lot of stock to somebody in WWE, and he was brought right in. They had some setup stuff for about a year, and here we are.
He's easy to hate.
Mm-hmm. And they want the Mexicans
heel.
In there.
He's amazing. He's perfect heel.
Like we talked before, we always complain because Batista was on top because he was great with the Mexican. Like we talked to Brandon earlier, they're going to do.
He's not Mexican.
Who?
What?
Batista. He's not Mexican.
No, but he's good with popular.
That Latino audience.
Yeah, he's popular with the Latino audience.
Sorry, we're not specific.
He is part Filipino, so I mean that. There you go.
Del Rio is such an amazing heel.
That's the thing. He's
that
good.
He got booed in Mexico.
Yes.
He got
really,
booed.
Did he?
Yeah. Yes. Go back and watch it.
He got cheered too. But he got booed. Like,
he got booed in Mexico.
To be fair, I think he was always half. To be fair, I think he was always a heel there.
Well, it doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter.
That's
He's
true.
A hometown guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Like a home country guy.
But also, Mexican
booed in Mexico City.
But also, we don't know how many matches have you seen in Mexico. We don't know how the audience reacts. You know how we go to Japan and they're all like polite and clapping and everything like that. There's not that crazy reaction. You go to Canada and you've seen what's happened there, obviously, especially when they did the Bret Hart stuff up there. We don't know how us. I haven't watched much Mexican. I've watched Lucha Libre USA. That doesn't count.
It doesn't count.
Okay. I don't know how Mexicans react. Maybe this is it. Maybe to them it's real. Maybe they're
still real to them.
Maybe to them they don't know any better. You know. I mean, it could be Mexico. You know. Who knows?
Del Rio. I would say at least from being there live at the pay per view, Del Rio got a good crowd base.
Okay. So yeah, there were some Del Rio supporters.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, just saying.
Well,
oh, wait, no, and actually, I'm sorry, 02K is correcting me and says, no, he was a babyface in Mexico. So, okay, there you go. That gives a little more credit to that.
Right. He's such an amazing heel that I get so excited when he comes out to piss me off.
Exactly, with his easy pass. Rizz, you had something to say?
Yeah.
With his easy pass.
Was he getting cheered because people liked him, or was it because there was that percentage that don't like Cena at all?
Yeah, that's the other thing.
I think it was a little bit of both.
Like, you can't really say, hey.
Well, that, and also, I mean, San Antonio has a large Hispanic audience. You know?
No.
What?
Really?
What?
Yes.
What are you talking about?
What do you mean, what am I talking about?
Wow.
That's...
Hey, Wrestlefan.
Bullshit. You're Wrestlefan. Fucking making it up, Wrestlefan.
Hey, who the fuck was there, okay?
Wait, Wrestlefan. Here's a little hint for you. The sky is blue.
Which is I'm just saying, that's my point. That's why I think it was...
It's freezing my blue man group off over here.
What?
I'm not sure
what the fuck?
I am not sure what that means.
There's a lot of Canadians in Alaska.
Just shut the fuck up.
We're just being sarcastic. It's sarcasm.
My point is, I think it was part because he was facing Cena, and part because he was Hispanic. That's just saying. Putting that out there. I think the drunk guys behind me liked him because he was Hispanic, so I don't know.
Hey, Wrestlefan.
What?
There's a lot of Irish people in Ireland.
You know, which being pointed out, YCP pointed out.
Move them white boy drivers.
There's a lot of my feet up your ass in a second.
How many black NASCAR drivers are there? The answer is none. There's one lady and she won't drive fast.
First off, Danica Patrick does drive fast. Secondly, isn't there a Mexican guy?
Juan Pablo Montoya, that motherfucker is awesome. He's done stuff with TNA, surprisingly. Bringing it back around.
So first off, that one Mexican equals five black guys.
Right? Wow, I like that we're breaking down borders here.
Breaking down borders.
Wow. NYCW does point out that Zero's from the Mexican border. He knows his Mexican shit. How many Asian NASCAR drivers Hot Wheels wants to know?
Oh, stop it.
I don't know why I read that.
None.
Any, to be honest.
None.
No. All right. Moving on. Anything else? I thought it was a solid show. I enjoyed just about everybody.
It was a good show that they put together 2 weeks.
Yeah, exactly.
There wasn't a bad match. Filler.
There was no Vengeance a year ago. That was pretty good. That was pretty good.
The only thing I wasn't happy with was Rizz. Miz and R-Truth running in.
At the end. I think that's a big thing. People have a problem with that match when they say it sucked. Like, four guys ran in and fucked with them. It's like,
actually, I did have a run in. So
yeah, Steven Rizz.
It was off air.
Yeah, it's like, come on, guys. That's how you beat John Cena, Super Cena, without him looking bad. That's how he's Super Cena. Come on. I mean, that's where Del Rio is. Del Rio's not going to get a clean win. He's a cheating bastard from Mexico.
Mexican bastards.
We like our Mexican friends, all right?
Easy Pass, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Easy Pass is awesome.
Yeah.
Sonic Screwjob makes a good point. Are you saying a 2-week lead was better than a 3-month build for Bound for Glory?
Yes.
Yes, actually.
His mugshot was his t-shirt.
I didn't get this last week. You didn't get this last week. I forgot about this. This is what I heard all night that Sunday. I think he said it in his sleep.
You bring back a criminal. A convicted felon. And you let him wear a t-shirt.
In all fairness.
That's his mugshot.
In all fairness, he served like... In all fairness, he served 10 days and they broke it up. I don't think that counts as him being a convicted felon.
He's a convicted felon!
He is convicted.
He was guilty to a felony charge. No matter what time he served, he still has a felony on his record.
Does that mean he can't vote?
Correct.
Who the fuck cares?
Not that he would anyhow.
I say, why is the mic so far from you?
But I was screaming before.
Oh, yeah.
So I moved the mic away.
That was very considerate.
Because his t-shirt was his fucking mugshot. My head hurts.
Because you're screaming.
No. I mean, how dumb do you have to be in TNA?
Well,
I swear to God, I will burn down their website if that t-shirt is available.
You will burn down their website with digital fire?
I will burn down their website if that t-shirt is available in their shop at any time.
I've been doing the watch for it, just in case.
Yeah.
See if that happens. I really don't think that's going to come up, though.
No, I think that was exactly.
I even looked on
another point.
What's that?
Mike brought up, especially when the 3-month build led to Rhodes' partner winning the title on a free TV show a few days later.
Mm-hmm.
What the fuck? Fuck you, yeah. TNA.
Yeah, that was ridiculous, and I agree.
God,
I agree with you.
And then. Just the fact that Bischoff and Hogan have the fucking audacity to go on Twitter and be like, we fucking planned it all along, Marks. No, you goddamn didn't. I swear to God, it is the stupidest, like, grade school thing to do.
We fooled you. Like, shut the fuck up.
Yeah, wrestlers using Twitter badly.
Yeah, Yeah, you're making a lot of friends by insulting your entire fucking audience by calling them marks.
Mm-hmm.
Bischoff has been insulting his entire audience from the start. He doesn't have any fans left. Please, no. Listeners of the Wrestling Mayhem Show, I beg of you, if one of you are a fan of Eric Bischoff, please write us and tell us why.
There you go.
Okay.
Let us know. Are there fans out there?
His t-shirt was his fucking mugshot.
His fans love the t-shirt. No?
They're as high as he is.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah, only in TNA, and I said this the other night when I was watching it with you guys. I'm like, only TNA, the convicted felon comes back, gets Symphony, and gets the pop.
Yep.
Yeah. Anyways, other than that, like you mentioned, Lance, John, James Storm, winning the belt.
No, let's talk about Lance. That.
No, James. No, that's fine. James. We don't need to talk about that other thing. So okay, I half listened to the spoilers when Wrestlefan always tells me after the show, and I thought he said Lance Storm.
There weren't spoilers; the show already happened.
But no, I heard before the fact that what was going to happen, and I swore that Wrestlefan told me that Lance Storm was going to be the new TNA champion.
Yeah, I told you Lance Storm.
That would
Storm
be awesome.
I know, right? I'm like, that's not that so bad. That's not bad at all. What's the problem here? Lance Storm, if I could be serious for a minute.
In my defense, I'm not the one that spoiled it. Mad Mike did last week.
Well, it was a Mad Mike? I don't know. Maybe he told me it was Lance Storm just to fuck
Mad Mike posted anyways. In the chat room last week.
I don't read this chat room. Well, hi, Mad Mike.
Oh, well, there you go.
His t-shirt was his mugshot. Yeah, and he got in like a minute. What?
68 seconds.
Obviously, Kurt Angle's injured. You saw the purple gunk between his bandage and his leg. You know, I mean, you know, obviously someone's up there to make a quick move. But James Storm, not that anything's wrong with James Storm. I think it's great. I think it's great. You know, it's a good. I'm happy to see it. You know?
I think it's fine, but Robert Roode is just seriously, he's such a better choice for a champion and.
Yeah. But there's because the whole argument was Hogan, I guess, was like, oh, Rude doesn't have it. Oh, you know what's the difference between Rude and Storm? What's the difference between Rude and Storm? Storm has a catchphrase.
Why
that's the
it?
Difference.
No, and just because Hulk Hogan was a dick and said how he wasn't ready on a radio show doesn't mean that's fully the reason why he didn't win the belt.
Well,
there's a little bit more involved than just Hulk Hogan.
I don't know who's involved in TNA. I don't know who has the power in TNA anymore.
You know what? Hey, first off, Mad Mike, I did watch the TNA show where James Storm won the belt.
Mm-hmm.
I happened to be home. I happened to be done watching whatever it was I was watching. Normally, I put on Spike
TV. You tweeted about it, too.
Yeah. Normally, I put on Spike TV because Repo Games is on or Deadly Warrior repeats are on. But,
awesome fucking show.
Say Deadliest Boner?
Warrior.
God, I need to start fucking watching wrestler TV.
Deadliest
again.
Boner.
But, I mean.
What's Deadliest Boner all goddamn day?
I realize I've only gotten two links or DVDs for indie wrestling, but I guarantee it's going to be better than the monkey writing scripts. Behind the scenes in TNA.
Throwing poop in a dartboard and seeing what sticks.
Because seriously, you know what happens in the TNA writing room? The monkey figures out how to take off his diaper, shits on a piece of paper, Eric Bischoff walks in, he goes, that's fucking genius! And walks out.
That's he jizzes all over it.
Yeah.
Gives it to Hogan. He takes a crap on it.
Like, seriously.
And sends it.
Every day, the monkey goes into the room with a diaper on. An hour later, Eric Bischoff walks in, picks up a shit-covered piece of paper, comes running out of the room going, guys, you gotta see what the monkey did today!
I'll say, people like on like the smart boards or whatever, complain about the rumors that like when Raw scripts come out, like they revise the Raw scripts like 10, 11 times. Yeah, that's better. That's better than writing a script 5 minutes before you fucking air a show and it's a piece of shit.
Wow, somebody didn't like WCW Nitro.
No, I didn't.
Anger wrestle fan.
Anger fan. All right, let's move up. I now that WrestleFan's blood pressure is suitably up, let's
Jeff
move on.
Jeff Jarrett's the monkey
story.
Wearing the diaper.
I don't think it's that.
I think it's Jeff Jarrett. Who the fuck is running TNA anymore?
He's not really that
I don't know
anymore. No, I know something that'll make you happier.
Oh no!
I swear to God, if it's not midgets, I'm walking out.
It's not midgets.
It's close.
Actually, I think midgets are further down in the lineup here. But almost as good. there's some ladies that were popping up around Halloween lately. What the hell was that sound?
What the hell was that?
What the hell is the sound you're making?
That was a I like Halloween lady
I swear,
sound.
I think this is the first,
like Halloween lady
this is
sound.
The first erotic haunted house I think I've seen, for one thing.
Wait, and, erotic haunted? I'll go to that.
Yes, with Lita.
The fuck is this?
Yes.
It's
an adult.
It's Lita molesting a dude with a baseball bat.
It's an adults-only haunted house in Atlanta, Georgia. Yes, there you go. Lita is.
Yeah, fuck that noise.
wait, you missing? She's electrocuting his nipples.
Yep.
Wow.
Is she
what the fuck?
Oh, I thought she was waterboarding.
No, that's cutting his head open. And brains.
And the brains.
So it's good to see Lita's getting work of some sort.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
There you go.
What the fuck?
What did I just see?
I don't know, but I got
I need to take my glasses off. My head hurts.
Did you say you have a chubby? Well, in other news, Katarina's Nightmare Theater is the other thing that popped up in the news this week, where I guess she's reviewing old horror movies?
Yep.
Such as The Devil Within Her and Humongous Uncut.
Bobby said that previous clip is the pilot for Deadliest Boner. 15,000 Chachi points for
Sorry, Amy,
Bobby.
And the other deal, and then there's Hulk Hogan.
Oh, come on.
Hulk Hogan in the NFL. Really? Did you hear this?
No, fuck
Did
this.
Did you hear this? No.
Did you hear this?
When I'm watching the Steelers-Cardinals game, and all of a sudden there's a biting remark from one of the main commentators about how Hulk Hogan apparently said some things about Tim Tebow.
Tim Tebow's a giant piece of shit. It's the only time I've agreed with Hulk Hogan. Yeah. That, make vitamins.
What is Hulk Hogan, the paraphrase, because I haven't seen the transcript to this anywhere. What the hell does... Hulk Hogan know about football. Nobody's cared what Hulk Hogan thinks about anything except for a fake sport, which the guy stumbled over, by the way.
And that's pushing it.
That's pushing it.
Yeah, that's... Yeah.
So
don't make me side with Hulk Hogan. Don't make me side with him.
Well, listen, number one, Tim Tebow is a giant crying baby.
Okay, what is the Tim Tebow deal?
He lost the
piece of shit.
He lost the BCS Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
Spent 3 hours crying afterwards because he lost the BCS Bowl. Okay. Got drafted in the first round, and then cried because they made him sit the bench.
Oh wow! Mm-hmm. Well, here's what Hulk Hogan thinks about that.
Well, you know, Tim Tebow looks like my shadow at high noon, brother.
Yeah. You know, at the end of the day, my arms are bigger than his legs.
Is he making fun of the fact he's black?
I can make his back crack, his knees freeze, or his liver quiver just by pointing at him, brother. So at the end of the day, if you want to be the bigger motivator, you got to have millions and millions a TiVo maniacs, which you don't, on your side.
So there you go. I can see the idea.
It's millions of Hulkamaniacs. When I start tearing this shit apart and ripping it apart, everybody wants to know what she gonna do when Tim Tebow, when Hulkamaniacs.
I mean, come on. That was a fun thing they did on ESPN out of nowhere. I'm sure he was. Hulk Hogan was on there promoting everything except for Impact Wrestling.
Okay,
Sonic Screwjob makes a really good point. Hmm. It's a promo.
Yeah, it's like, come on, Hulk Hogan's being Hulk Hogan.
Okay, first off, he did it wrong.
He did it wrong?
Because, let's face it.
You're telling Hulk Hogan how to be Hulk Hogan?
No, let's face it, all right? Number one, he did it wrong.
Okay.
Because at this point in time, anything Hulk Hogan does is wrong.
Okay. Wrong.
Number two, when you go on ESPN... And this is just going to show how WWE did it right and TNA or Hulk Hogan did it wrong. When you go on ESPN, you take it seriously and you actually discuss the sports.
Wait. First of all, we don't know what show he was on.
Sports Nation.
And I'm what kind of show is Sports Nation, Rizz?
It's like a topic of discussion that lets like fans decide what's the right answer, and it's
pretty
like,
stupid.
And now I've seen some like in the Sports Center commercials and everything. Not all of ESPN is serious, right?
No.
Right? I mean, that's general.
Doesn't matter.
I mean, they had a live studio audience for
Christ's sake. Yeah, yeah. I mean, this is one of those shows where they kind of take it off to a different direction. And that seems like more like Hulk Hogan can be Hulk Hogan in this environment, and they were having fun with it. I mean, Hulk Hogan got to go on as the cartoon character of Hulk Hogan to promote him being a cartoon character of Hulk Hogan. But we don't
see,
care. This is how Hulk Hogan conducts business.
See rule number one.
This is how Hulk Hogan conducts business.
See point number one.
I don't disagree with you, Sorg. That's just a great lie.
See point number one.
What?
That Hulk Hogan is wrong because anything he does at this point is wrong.
All right. That's enough of that. You know who else is? He was a little bit more serious when he showed up as part of the E60 show where they had a special about Scott Hall and all the problems that Scott Hall has had. I was really surprised all the people they had on this. Eric Bischoff was interviewed for this. Stephanie McMahon talking about the six figures they've spent on his rehab that obviously hasn't worked. Kevin Nash, of course, has talked to on this. Sean Waltman, of course, details basically his entire career and his problems through the career.
Guys, he killed someone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I shot somebody in the head. It was what? Yes,
but you need to watch it.
No, I'm not kidding. Actually, the episode is posted over our friends, thewrestlingrevolution.com. That's where I found it. What's that?
I said email
it's
me.
It's tweeted.
That link.
I tweeted the link. Actually, you should watch it.
Email me that link.
Okay. Email everybody that link. Wow. Chachi. So angry.
Well, I don't click on stuff that you tweet.
Okay, anyways. He doesn't trust my tweets. Yeah. But it goes into all of it, including the promoter.
I will talk about poop with DJ Lunchbox.
We'll talk about poop now.
Via text message, but I will not click your tweets.
And you have to watch Wrestling Mayhem Show Gold to figure out what the fuck he's talking about. But no, it was a good piece. And really sad. Really sad.
It was super sad.
Now I was going into this a little bit earlier with somebody, but Sean Waltman, of course, very angry. This showing here, he had not seen the footage. But of course, Hall went out inebriated, apparently had a seizure and was in the hospital the night before and was pushed out at an indie show. And that's what made a lot of news about how sad it was. Interesting, and I wonder what you guys think about this. The promoter states, Scott Hall is not my friend. I made that determination when he showed up the way he did. I wasn't going to refund these fans. They paid to see Scott Hall. I was going to show him Scott Hall. Scott Hall had to be helped to the ring. Dressed Incredible is interviewed on this, PJ Polacco. And he says it was the saddest thing he had to be involved with because he was part of the match that Scott was involved in. Sean was like, this guy's a piece of shit for letting him do this.
I got something for that.
Okay.
I'm a little indifferent. First of all, Scott Hall should not have shown up.
Yes.
He had a seizure. He was in the hospital. And he was highly medicated.
Mm-hmm. And also,
as you can see in the video.
And to me, I'm thinking if I was a businessman and I would not book Scott Hall or Jake Roberts, who has a history of this that I don't feel I would be able to depend on for the history you know of. You know?
Right.
Unless you know something different. I'm sorry, Riz?
Sorry. I said the blame doesn't fully go on Scott Hall, though, because the promoter also had a blame in this because he let him go out in that ring.
And what's the point? Okay, say I book a guy. Yeah, we don't know. Did Scott Hall tell him I was in the hospital for a seizure? I'm on medication. That's why I'm fucked up.
No, he came out.
No, he came up. He looked fucked up. There's a guy with a history of alcoholism. If I booked said wrestler and he showed up drunk, you know,
demanding his money,
and you know, I'm not say booking him in a wrestling match because you know that would just be unsafe. For the other person, to be honest.
Right.
But he went out to the walk out there and say things and be ringside for a match. That's manageable. If he has the unprofessionalism to show up like that, why does the business owner have to take the cut and give out refunds?
The the blame falls on both people.
Yes. Yeah. In the long run, yes.
Scott Hall shouldn't have shown up. Yes.
Exactly. You're right.
He shouldn't have
walked.
Or
he should.
Or at least said stop. Was in the fucking
stop.
Stop. Stop stepping on him.
Stop.
Sorry.
It's okay. Scott Hall shouldn't have walked in the building.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. And I know was, this is going to sound redundant.
I want to say, and he was on drugs on top of what the hospital drugs.
And I'm going to say that this is kind of going to sound funny because we're talking about wrestling. But it's the promoter's job to provide a safe working environment for his talent.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, what they do is already dangerous enough. But to let someone that fucked up into the ring, and God knows what he could have done, and put your other talent at risk, so that's where the fall blames on the promoter.
Exactly. Exactly. But again, I don't think, you know, this is a, wasn't a wrestling match. I think that was a little different. That he was that fucked up, he had to have three people help him in the ring. That was a little bit rough. But yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was helped to the ring.
Yeah.
But go check that out. That's definitely, if you didn't catch it, if you didn't TiVo, I don't know if they're probably replayed. I don't know how ESPN works. I don't have cable. But yeah, it's definitely making the rounds. Yeah. Anything else you guys want to bring up before we head out of here this week?
Nope.
No.
Like, hey, Sorg.
Hey.
What'd you learn from wrestling?
You're starting with me?
Yep.
You're really? Starting with me?
Yep.
Oh.
I learned. You know, I learned this week. And we didn't even mention IWC. IWC had a fantastic 10-year anniversary show this
past weekend. Oh, yeah, that's right.
Somebody didn't send any email to remind me about it. Messy. you know, I guess we're just going to go with that. And you're just going to go to IWCWrestling.com and check that out. I recommend the DVD. Some good videographers on that. But I learned how a Fans Bring the Weapon match can stay with you for several days. In my case, because I was walking through the cafe on Monday, full 2 days afterwards, and heard clicking in my shoes. Now, Fans Bring the Weapons, there's all kinds of stuff in there, including what was a deemed and written on it, a tack-o-lantern. There were tacks.
Oh my goodness, that's awesome.
There were tacks in a pumpkin, and they used it.
But shit,
and,
that's phenomenal.
Well, I looked at my shoes as they clicked on the hardwood floor, and I was like, oh, there are tacks in my shoes. I got some souvenirs. apparently, I learned that in a Fans Bring the Weapon match, dude, the shit's up for grabs after the match.
Did you grab the taco lantern?
I did not grab it. It was already destroyed. I almost
Dombrowski stole the guitar.
Yes, Dombrowski.
One of the guitars.
Dombrowski rode up with me. And he came, he's like, I have a guitar. It was a good night. I'm like, how the fuck did you get the guitar? I had to ask him about it three times before I got the answer.
You don't know what disease is on that guitar.
Yes. That is that too.
But still, there was a lot of crazy shit they didn't show.
There was a lot
show.
Of crazy shit in that. There was a lot of crazy shit, yeah, that they didn't even use. There was a TNA Impact Wii game that got used.
And there was a Goldberg punching bag.
Oh, I didn't see that. There was, of course, the typical dildo and condoms for Jimmy DeMarco.
And there was a huge tire that came in.
There was a tire. It was a Pontiac. Had a Hubcap on it still. That's probably worth some money. But yeah, it was fantastic. It was ridiculous. Utterly ridiculous. And I was far too close to a in-ring fireball.
Jesus.
Far too close. I don't even know if I got it on footage because they turned the lights out. Anyways. Let's go over to you since you're helping me out with that one. Rizz, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
Well, I learned that a man dressed up as a jack-o'-lantern can scare a kid very easily.
What?
Yeah, Hallow Wicked.
Okay.
No. Dresses up like a jack-o'-lantern.
Yeah.
With a stick on his head.
With the stem on his head.
Yeah.
And at the IWC show that we just mentioned, there were these two kids, brother and sister, I guess, about maybe 4, maybe 5 years old. They were going up trying to, you know, slap hands with the wrestlers. And Hallow Wicked comes up, roars in their face, and the kids just go off scurrying off to the side. Then they come back, like during the middle of the match, and Hallow Wicked does it again. They go flying off crying even more. Then they come back at the end of the match. Hollow Wicked tries to shake his shake their hand, and I guess you know where this is going.
Poor Hollow Wicked.
The Hollow Wicked just want love.
DJ Lunchbox, what'd you learn from wrestling this fine week?
I learned Hollow Wicked just want love. I learned, hopefully, and I'll report back on this, how to get my girlfriend into professional wrestling.
Woo! Nice. Wrestlefan! Roasting of the moment.
I learned from wrestling this week that at WWE live events, they need to institute a new drink limit as far as how many beers you can have at one night.
No, they don't.
Yeah. I said they should because there were okay. So the people behind me and like I was in my section. I was like the top row or whatever. Above me, there were these guys sitting. It was like a table, but not really. They had to. Each one of them had to have like 6 beer bottles for each of them. They were they yelled during the Divas match that they wanted to fuck Eve Torres. They yelled
sober sometimes.
Yeah, they yelled for John Cena to fucking kill Alberto Del Rio or something. Which, by the way, like to the right to the left of me was a kid that couldn't have been more than like 3 years old. And these guys are screaming fuck every other word.
Hey man, he's got to learn this shit sometime.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I swear they were banging on those tables like repeatedly during the match. I think they almost spilled one of their beers on me. That would have been no bueno. People in the chat learned stuff.
Chachi, what did you learn?
Oh, Chachi, there you go.
I learned that it really has been over 7 years. Since the last time WWE imploded
a ring. That's right, seven-year roll in effect. They can use it again.
All right, so Sonic Screwjob has learned the following. JR needs to be careful tweeting. He may want to run for Senate one day.
Mm-hmm.
If someone doesn't get a hold of our truth, you won't be able to take water bottles on planes anymore. microphones at Raw need spit shields. And Cena is a Fresh Prince fan.
That's right. Mad Mike learned
a lot.
Mike learned that CM Punk needs to put some money in the cubbies.
On the cubbies.
Okay. Bobby FJ Town learned, and now they did this last night, or I wouldn't know how to do this. So please help me out if you know the tune. Take this broken ring and learn to fight again. The British watches shit for free. Was that good enough? Was that good?
That was pretty good.
Okay. I know AJ and Bobby aren't here, so I saw a few on Skype real quick.
Sarah2K learned that there are Hispanics in San Antone.
Yes. San Anton.
Yes.
Your Crafts Week learned Super Dragon clap, 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 clap. Mad Mike also
didn't play that video yet.
Mad Mike also learned that the murdering bastard David R. Demir got to fuck some whores with CJ Sensation.
Yes, he did. And he also is ripping off D'Lo Brown's moves. Just throwing that out there.
Yeah. I think Mad Mike said something racist to me.
That's nothing new. No. All right, guys. Thanks a lot for joining us. We do this crazy shit live every Tuesday or so at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time.
Tuesday?
Live.sorgatronmedia.com. Of course, you can find all the information at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Tweet us at Mayhem Show. Drop us emails.
Good times.
Send me DVD.
Good times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. 412-206. WMS09670. Guys, buy the app, watch us on iTunes and YouTube, follow us on Facebook.
Buy the hookers.
Thanks a lot, guys. Everybody in the chat room has been awesome. Thanks for everybody that's tuning in and chatting with us and sharing shit with the show. Thank you for Brandon from RCW for joining us. We'll see you guys next week. Mayhem out. Just wait.